Calorama, a recorded books, High Bridge imprint, presents Capturing News, Capturing Democracy, Trump and the Voice of America. By Kate Wright, Martin Scott, and Mel Bunce. Read by Tom Campbell. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. 1. Introduction. Half of Americans know, in their gut, that the government no longer represents the will of the people. They need to rise up and demand an end to this tyranny. So wrote Michael Pack, who was nominated by President Donald Trump as Chief Executive Officer of the U.S. Agency for Global Media, USAGM, which oversees all U.S.-funded international media. The tyranny that Pack complained so bitterly about was government by unelected bureaucrats, who, he argued, had made it impossible for him to assume authority over the agency, thereby subverting the will of the Democratic majority who had voted for Trump. What Pack did not mention was that USAGM is an independent federal agency, and that the international media networks the agency oversees have their freedom of speech guaranteed by law, as well as having organizational mechanisms in place to protect their impartiality. Nevertheless, this book explains that during Pack's time in office, USAGM became intensely politicized. This process of politicization happened very quickly. Pack was only in office for 7 months, from June 11, 2020 to January 20, 2021. He resigned at the request of President Joe Biden, a mere 2 hours after Biden took office. During that time, Pack and the team he brought to USAGM carried out a highly controversial program of reforms. Many of these reforms focused on the oldest and largest U.S.-funded international media organization, Voice of America, VOA. VOA disseminates broadcast and digital content in 48 languages and has an international audience of more than 326 million people. Thus, VOA is one of the most influential international public service media organizations in the world, although it is less widely known within the U.S. because it does not broadcast domestically. Dissatisfaction with VOA was the main reason Trump cited for his nomination of Pack as the new Chief Executive Officer, CEO, of USAGM. Specifically, Trump said he wanted Pack to curb what he believed was VOA's overly negative reporting of the U.S. As he put it, "If you heard what's coming out of the Voice of America, it's disgusting. What things they say are disgusting toward our country." Pack had previously been the director of the U.S.-funded international satellite TV network WorldNet, as well as serving as the co-chair of the International TV Council at the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and later as its senior vice president for television programming. He was also a right-wing documentary filmmaker and close friend of Steve Bannon, the founder of the far-right media outlet Breitbart News, and the chief White House strategist in the early months of the Trump administration. Bannon is alleged to have urged Trump to take control of VOA since he served in the White House, saying that the International News Network was a rotten fish from top to bottom. It's now totally controlled by the deep state apparatus. Pack seems to have viewed USAGM in a similar light, explaining that his objectives as CEO were to drain the swamp, to root out corruption, and to deal with these issues of bias. He began by dismissing all the heads of the international media organizations under the USAGM umbrella, except for VOA's director and deputy director, who resigned. He dissolved the bipartisan boards of each news organization and suspended most of USAGM's executives. Some of these executives were investigated by private law firms, including McGuire Woods, which Pack paid using $1.6 million of taxpayers' money. Pack also froze the financial budgets of all U.S.-funded international media and halted their recruitment of staff. He did not apply to extend the visas needed by foreign journalists, resulting in several being sent back to authoritarian countries, even though there were fears it would place these journalists and their families in danger. In addition, Pack's team influenced the network's internal disciplinary procedures, targeting journalists who they regarded as biased against Trump in the run-up to the presidential election in November 2020. Some VOA staff worked with colleagues in USAGM to pursue lawsuits and file whistleblower complaints against PAC. Shortly before the election, PAC was subpoenaed by the U.S. Congress to respond to serious concerns about his leadership of the agency, but he failed to appear. Immediately after the election, a district court judge took the unprecedented step of issuing a partial injunction against PAC and his team, forbidding them from interfering in VOA's editorial affairs or participating in related disciplinary investigations because they were restricting journalists' First Amendment right to freedom of speech. Meanwhile, other members of the U.S. press speculated that PAC was trying to turn VOA into a partisan mouthpiece, the voice of Trump. Finally, shortly before Biden's inauguration, PAC's appointees facilitated a visit to VOA's headquarters by the then Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, who insisted that the network live stream his speech in full. In that speech, Pompeo chastised VOA for being too critical of U.S. government policies, arguing that the network should promote the U.S. as the greatest nation the world has ever known. Pompeo made no mention of the attempted insurrection that had taken place 5 days before in Washington, D.C., nor were journalists permitted to ask questions about it. The VOA's White House correspondent attempted to ask Pompeo two questions by doorstepping him after the event. Immediately afterward, PAC's appointees reassigned the correspondent and the director of the network's main newsroom to other duties. 20 VOA employees then signed a formal complaint arguing that the Pompeo event and its aftermath indicated that the Trump administration was using the network to promote political propaganda. The controversy over PAC's leadership of USAGM has been described by academics as a particularly intense episode in a long-running struggle over different approaches to public diplomacy in the U.S. This struggle has been portrayed as a tug of war between the opposing principles of partisanship and journalistic professionalism. But an extensive investigation conducted at the request of the U.S. government's Office of Special Counsel, OSC, was far more damning. It found that during the 7 months that PAC was in office, he engaged in numerous improper activities, some of which constituted abuse of authority, gross mismanagement, gross waste of funds, and the violation of laws, rules, and regulations. Investigators also stressed that PAC had taken actions that were inconsistent with the statutory mandate that he respect the network's journalistic independence and integrity, and that he had exercised oversight in a manner suggestive of political bias. In this book, we demonstrate why, how, and to what extent VOA was politicized during PAC's period in office, and explore the various effects of this politicization. To answer these questions, we conducted 20 lengthy interviews with staff at VOA and USAGM. We triangulated these interviews with the analysis of media items produced by PAC and his allies, and 15,000 pages of documents, most of which were obtained via Freedom of Information, FOI, requests. To analyze this material, we used the theoretical lens of government capture, that is, the process of intensification of political influence, shaped by governments and their political allies, which constrains journalists' ability to criticize those in power. A key issue in our analysis involved considering whether the patterns of politicization that took place during PAC's time in office corresponded to those found in previous cases of the government capture of public service media around the world. Almost all these previous cases involved countries experiencing democratic backsliding, including Hungary, Poland, Turkey, and South Africa. Strong correlations with those earlier cases were the first indications we found that the controversy over PAC's leadership of USAGM might involve far more than a disagreement over different approaches to public diplomacy. As our research progressed, we found more definitive evidence that the politicization of VOA under PAC's leadership fed into broader patterns of de-democratization within the U.S. PAC said he was concerned that U.S. citizens might be influenced by VOA's biased coverage of the election online or via social media. Specifically, he was concerned that VOA might influence Muslim voters, who form part of the diasporic groups that seek out VOA to consume news in their own languages. Such diasporic groups form an increasingly significant voting bloc in some swing states. Pack also appears to have been worried that prominent VOA journalists might influence other members of the U.S. media via their personal social media accounts. For these reasons, Pack pursued disciplinary investigations into news items and individual journalists for anti-Trump bias. These investigations generated what some of our interviewees called a climate of fear that, when combined with other factors, prompted journalists to engage in significant forms of self-censorship. A district court judge even ruled that Pack and his team had infringed VOA journalists' constitutional right to freedom of speech. We expand on this ruling by showing how journalists not only limited their critical reporting of the administration, but also deployed forms of false balance, which started to shift VOA's output in Trump's favor. However, the extent to which VOA's output could have influenced the electoral playing field in the U.S. is questionable, given the relatively small number of U.S. citizens consuming VOA content online and on social media. The network still has a reputation for flying below the radar of American audiences because it does not broadcast in the U.S. Given the surge in traffic to niche right-wing media sites in 2020, a more significant impact on U.S. voters may have arisen from the way Pack and his allies spoke about VOA within these kinds of media outlets. Such media contributions tended to frame Pack's oversight of VOA, as well as his management of USAGM, in terms of a battle against foreign spies, liberal journalists, civil servants, and other globalists. Pro-Trump journalists, social media participants, and popular conspiracy sites then amplified the narratives of Pack and his allies via niche online sites and on social media. Their representations of VOA often further exaggerated what Pack said, using mediated discourse about VOA to feed Trumpian narratives, already in circulation, about the existence of a conspiratorial deep state and related status threats to white conservative nationalist American identity. 3 weeks before the election, the Gateway Pundit and other right-wing media actors even spread a conspiracy theory that VOA had enabled Biden to call U.S. Muslim voters to jihad. Thus, this right-wing media network distorted Pack's claims about VOA to undermine faith in American democratic institutions and processes, contributing to broader forms of de-democratizing discourse that inclined some Trump supporters to accept his claim that the election was stolen from him. Moreover, we found that the processes involved in politicizing VOA appeared to contribute to state-led Democratic backsliding. Pack's attorneys worked with White House officials to rescind federal regulation about the firewall guarding the independence of U.S.-funded international media, a move that Pack justified by saying that the Constitution gives the president broad latitude in directing the foreign policy of the United States. In this book, we will argue that the body of accumulated law regarding VOA's relationship to the U.S. government is indeed unclear on many points. But USAGM is an independent federal agency that, by definition, is supposed to be insulated from direct presidential control. Thus, we find it hard to see this move as anything other than an expansion of executive power that undermined democratic checks and balances designed to prevent the state from becoming conflated with the ruling administration. This shift, known in political theory as executive aggrandizement, is a common feature of democratic backsliding. Nevertheless, we think the most serious risk to U.S. democracy posed by the increased politicization of VOA was how easy it would still be for a U.S. government with authoritarian leanings to capture the network and use it to influence U.S. citizens at home. Other scholars have previously raised serious concerns about the capacity of VOA and other U.S.-funded international media to target U.S. citizens via paid-for digital advertisements placed on social media. We were told, anonymously, that only a few technical changes were needed if some future government appointees wished to turn VOA into a significant domestic broadcaster. There are some legal measures in place to prevent VOA and other U.S.-funded international media from targeting U.S. citizens, which we will discuss in the next chapter. But these are all difficult to enforce, and it is unlikely to deter someone willing to break the law. Indeed, as Greigel and Sager have argued, if further safeguards are not put in place, it would not take long for USAGM to be on a par with one or more of the major independent cable networks. This could lead to the U.S. government becoming one of the primary domestic broadcasters of news-like information, a role often assumed by governments in autocratic countries. The current crisis in U.S. democracy means that urgent action must be taken to prevent the possibility of VOA being used to target U.S. citizens for partisan reasons. Shortly before the book went into production, Trump was indicted by a grand jury on 4 counts, all of which related to his alleged attempt to overturn the results of the presidential election in 2020. This indictment included 3 charges of conspiracy and 1 of obstructing an official proceeding. 6 unnamed co-conspirators were listed as allegedly helping the president further his false claims. Trump and 18 other defendants have also been charged under state racketeering and conspiracy laws in the state of Georgia. Trump has denied any wrongdoing, claiming that the charges against him are designed to ruin his race for the White House in 2024. At the time of writing, none of PAC's team had been charged with any legal offense. We also do not wish to imply that PAC or any other member of his team considered using VOA for anti-democratic purposes. However, we did identify several connections among PAC, his team, and individuals named by the January 6th Senate committee as key actors in conspiracies to overturn the results of the 2020 presidential election. The presence of these connections does not necessarily prove anything other than these people were part of the same close-knit network of Trump appointees and supporters. Yet, such connections serve to alert us to how serious the consequences of politicizing VOA could have been and could still be. Numerous studies show that those seeking to overthrow democratic governments often seek to gain control over state-funded broadcasting facilities. Indeed, these media networks are frequently among their first targets. Such broadcasters are not necessarily used to drum up support before a coup, but they are essential to disseminating the message after the successful overthrow of a government. Our point here is not that PAC or his team were involved in any such conspiracy, but that there was, and still is, little to stop others from using VOA in this way, apart from journalists themselves. Thus, our first motivation in writing this book was to raise the alarm about how vulnerable the news network is to government capture and to explain why this matters in terms of democratic backsliding as well as international diplomacy. 1.1. Government Capture from the Inside. Our second motivation for authoring this book was to develop better understandings of how government capture works, using the rich and rare data set we acquired via our exclusive access to VOA. This access involved us conducting 20 lengthy retrospective interviews in spring-summer 2022. We interviewed all the most senior managers at VOA, a selection of journalists working in English and other languages, and 2 respondents in VOA's parent agency, USAGM, who were present throughout PAC's time in office and were able to verify allegations made by VOA staff. Such access is extremely unusual, as dominant forms of journalistic autonomy mean that government capture is a sensitive topic of research for any news organization. Public service journalists who admit to government capture run even greater risks because the legitimacy of such news organizations is based on their difference from state-run media. Public service journalists are also especially vulnerable to retribution because of the government's influence over their funding and, sometimes, their managerial structures. Recent leaks of email and WhatsApp messages from inside the BBC suggest that public service journalists may become so seriously concerned about perceived government influence that they are willing to share insider insights and related material with outsiders, albeit anonymously. But this is highly unusual. So, there is extraordinarily little research into the government capture of public service media, PSM, which incorporates the insights of managers and journalists working for such organizations. Instead, research into the government capture of PSM has tended to be conducted outside these news organizations, often in the form of comparative meta-analyses. Other scholars have chosen to protect participants' anonymity by obscuring whether journalists speaking about PSM were employed by such outlets or worked elsewhere. Research into the capture of public media is therefore not as developed as research into the capture of commercial news organizations, which incorporate insider insights more often. However, relying on insider accounts alone is problematic, as interviewees may provide unreliable narratives about what happened, sometimes omitting, misunderstanding, or misrepresenting important events and processes. Interviewees may also frame themselves and their organization in an overly positive light or give post hoc rationalizations for their actions. In a fraught political context, there is also the risk that interviewees may have their own hidden political motives or agendas. These factors make it difficult to ascertain from research interviews alone whether increased politicization of the news organization really did take place, let alone why and how it took place and its various effects. For these reasons, scholars researching the increased politicization of PSM should triangulate insider interviews with other bodies of data. Ideally, this should include contemporaneous data, which supplements retrospective interviews by shedding light on government capture at the time. Data about the private interactions of government officials, government appointees, and their allies are likely to be particularly valuable, but is the most difficult data of all to access. This study is the first to combine those different sorts of data within an innovative mixed methods approach. We analyzed 12,000 pages of documents drawn from archives created by FOI requests, a much underused method for identifying data about internal processes of governing. Since PAC's period of leadership coincided with the COVID-19 pandemic, when most staff worked remotely from home, digital correspondence was far more abundant than it might otherwise have been. The archives we examined included numerous emails and Teams messages, which might have been the subject of in-person conversations in other circumstances. For these reasons, we had a unique opportunity to analyze detailed digital conversations between PAC and other pro-Trump officials, whom he brought to USAGM, between PAC's team and VOA staff, between PAC's team and right-wing media, and between PAC's team and White House officials. Having access to this data was particularly important because of the nature of our interview sample. When we carried out our empirical research, the OSC investigation was still ongoing. This investigation was extremely sensitive, including a review of whistleblowers' complaints about retaliatory actions carried out against them by others in USAGM. We were also aware that the OSC investigation could lead to criminal and civil lawsuits. We did not wish to risk disrupting these delicate processes, so took the difficult decision not to approach PAC, his appointees, and some other individuals for interviews. Instead, we used other documentation, including the correspondence that these actors had with each other, to verify, test, and challenge what our interviewees told us. We contextualized this data by analyzing over 3,000 pages of secondary data. These included government reports, documents about legal cases, videos, and transcripts from the Select Committee hearings on the January 6th insurrection. We also included data from the OSC report, which included interviews with two members of PAC's team, and which was published as we were finishing the book. Finally, we analyzed a range of various kinds of mainstream, niche, and social media. This included cross-platform analysis of the amplification and exaggeration of Michael PAC's claims by right-wing actors online and on social media, and network analysis of the dissemination of conspiracy theories about VOA on Twitter. We also conducted critical discourse analysis of USAGM press releases, as well as the media contributions made by PAC and the VOA director who PAC appointed after the election, Robert Riley. Our analysis of these different data sets enabled us to build new theory about why government capture occurs, how it occurs, and its harmful effects on democratic practice. A key aspect of this involved developing understandings about the extent to which previous theory about the capture of national PSM corresponds to the capture of international PSM. Although previous critical concepts were useful, we needed to refine them to address the causal factors at work in the VOA case, which related specifically to its status as an international news network. These factors included VOA's ambivalent diplomatic role and its need to access specific kinds of human resources, foreign staff with the linguistic skills and regional expertise required by language services. Therefore, our third motivation in writing this book was to generate greater understanding of the relationships between international PSM and the governments that fund them. 1.2. International Public Service Media. International PSM are rarely studied, despite the wide reach of these global news organizations. Together, the world's largest international PSM, known collectively as the Director General 8, achieve more than 1.5 billion weekly audience contacts with their online, social, and broadcast media. These organizations are ABC Australia, BBC World Service, CBC Radio Canada, Deutsche Welle, France Media Monde, NHK World Japan, Swiss Info, and the U.S.-funded international media organizations that fall under USAGM, including VOA. Each member of the Director General 8 has its own unique structural features, yet these international news networks also have much in common. They are funded by democratic governments and claim to enable cross-border dialogue and information flows. This is particularly important in countries where there is little media freedom and during international crises, like the COVID-19 pandemic. Thus, international PSM share some of the normative goals of national PSM, eschewing financial profit in favor of facilitating the public knowledge, meaningful dialogue, and collective representation necessary for democratic interaction. However, international PSM also draw from political discourse, prevalent after World War II, about the use of international radio broadcasting to foster international dialogue and build mutual understanding to safeguard international peace. This discourse has since been blended with other normative ideas, which accompanied the rise of international satellite TV and the Internet. These ideas include the hope that international journalism might foster a global public sphere or other forms of progressive global citizenship. To prevent their journalistic credibility from being undermined by the partisan objectives of specific administrations, international PSM seek to separate editorial and diplomatic activity via legislative, regulatory, and institutional barriers. The U.S. tends to emphasize legal barriers, which are referred to collectively as the firewall. These barriers have long been regarded as differentiating international PSM from international state media, like Russia Today, RT, and China Global Television Network, CGTN, which are directly and wholly controlled by ruling parties. Nevertheless, despite the claims made by international PSM regarding their editorial independence and impartiality, they are not apolitical organizations. International PSM were founded and continue to be funded for reasons of public diplomacy. Although they are not meant to advocate on behalf of any political party, they do enhance their country's national image, language, and values abroad. Indeed, these kinds of transnational media often play a crucial role in mediating nationhood. The funding and strategic plans of international PSM are also shaped by diplomatic concerns, including the location of former colonies, diaspora, threats to national security, and the emergence of new international rivals or enemies. Such diplomatic concerns have a direct impact on journalist work, shaping the languages they work in and the geographic areas they cover. Changes in diplomatic objectives over time also mean the laws and institutional structures that shape the relationships of international PSM to their funding government tend to have an accumulated quality. Older approaches are rarely scrapped when new models arrive. Instead, these older approaches tend to be modified and combined with new approaches, creating additional sources of tension. VOA is a prime example of this. Several decades after the end of the Cold War, the news network is still embedded within a government agency, so its journalists and managers are federal employees, and its director and deputy director are political appointees. So, this is an unusual case of government capture in which the news network in question was, in some senses, already part of the federal system. Nevertheless, USAGM and all U.S.-funded international media, including VOA, are supposed to operate independently of the executive branch of government. VOA's editorial independence is supposed to be safeguarded by law, but the wording of this legislation is imprecise, making it hard to apply in practice. VOA's charter is also decidedly ambivalent. It contains legally binding obligations relating to the dominant journalistic norms of accuracy and objectivity, as well as a point relating to the presentation of a balanced and comprehensive projection of significant American thought and institutions. However, VOA's charter still obliges the network to present the policies of the U.S. government clearly and effectively, albeit within the context of discussions and opinions on these policies. Further legislation also obliges the network to disseminate government editorials. Although a policy office produces these editorials to keep them separate from VOA's journalism. For these reasons, questions are sometimes raised about whether VOA should be categorized alongside other state media, rather than as an international PSM. The network is still one of only two members of the Director General 8 to be embedded in a government agency, and the only member obliged to carry government editorials. But several other members of the Director General 8 are led or regulated by government appointees, and many have ambivalent mandates that attempt to combine journalistic norms with the promotion of national interests. In addition, international PSM are all renegotiating their relationships with domestic audiences following the growth of online and social media. Diaspora are an obvious focus of critical attention here, as they may seek out news about their country of origin and their country of residence in their primary language. Wang and Hong argued that this phenomenon may help explain why, when they conducted their analysis of VOA's main news site, voanews.com, the most frequently referring country was the U.S., comprising around a third of all site visits. When we analyzed traffic in the year of the presidential election, 2020, we found the proportion seemed to be even higher. 45% of all traffic appeared to come from the U.S., comprising around 18 million site visits. However, when we discussed this issue with VOA, senior managers showed us more detailed data, which demonstrated that, first, audiences usually search in their primary language. They don't tend to use the English language site, voanews.com, as a landing page to reach news in other languages. Second, VOA managers showed us chronological data, which suggested that some of the traffic supposedly coming from the U.S. was likely from news consumers in authoritarian countries in a different time zone who were using U.S. circumvention tools to overcome internet filters. Moreover, it is worth stressing that the total number of visits to voanews.com, which appeared to be coming from the U.S. in 2020, was only 18 million. This is a tiny fraction of the number of U.S. visits to sites of major national news organizations. Nevertheless, the mixed nature of VOA's audiences is important, particularly since similar web data for 2020 showed that most traffic to the main news sites for Radio France Internationale and Deutsche Welle also arrived from the countries that fund these networks. The domestic audiences of international PSM also seem likely to fluctuate over time in accordance with major news events, including major elections. Using similar web data, we found that U.S. visits to voanews.com had surged by nearly 30% between 2019 and 2020, with popular keyword searches including terms relating to the presidential election, including Obamagate. Thus, although the number of domestic citizens who consume news disseminated by international PSM are still much smaller than those achieved by national media, the relationship between such networks and the countries that fund them is clearly changing. Put bluntly, it is now impossible to neatly separate international diplomacy and domestic politics. Therefore, although VOA has some distinctive structural features which deserve careful, critical attention, we have continued to categorize it as an international PSM network in this book for three reasons. First, as we have argued here, the category of international PSM is a meaningful one within industry and government, enabling useful comparisons to be made between the major international media organizations that form the Director General 8. By retaining this category, we hope to encourage such organizations, as well as the legislators and regulators in their funding countries, to consider the potential implications of the VOA case for their own practice. Second, the notion of international public service was meaningful to our interviewees, shaping their understandings of their work, their normative commitments, and the basis upon which several tried to resist government capture. Third, and finally, we see international PSM as facing a common challenge. That is, how to reconceptualize their relationship to funding countries now that it is no longer possible to separate their output from domestic news in today's fluid, hybrid media system. 1.3. Resisting government capture. Examining the resistance of some VOA staff to government capture was the most heartening aspect of this study, but it is also significant, theoretically. Researchers who study democratic backsliding stress that governments must be prevented from co-opting media organizations. The capture of PSM is often seen as particularly problematic, as this can be an important stepping stone toward capturing the whole media system. But there is little research about why and how the staff of a news organization, let alone a PSM network, might try to resist politicization themselves. Indeed, our previous research showed that journalists working for international PSM tend to justify shifts in their relationships with funding governments, even when these changes make them feel anxious or uncomfortable. What was especially striking about the VOA case was how many senior executives played a leading role in resisting government capture. This may surprise some listeners, as news managers have been consistently associated with the conservative top-down control of journalists and media sociology studies from the 1950s onward. In previous studies of the politicization of PSM, managers have often enforced, or passively enabled, the increased influence of government appointees and their allies, rather than trying to stop it. So, our fourth motivation to author this book involved taking the opportunity to examine why and how senior managers and journalists at VOA work together to resist government capture, as well as assessing the efficacy of the various strategies they used. This last point is likely to be of great interest to political scholars, as VOA staff engaged in precisely the kinds of moderate institutional strategies thought to be most effective in opposing democratic backsliding. These strategies include mounting legal challenges, making formal complaints to accountability bodies, and working with civil society organizations, as well as leaking to Congress and journalists working for other media outlets. However, research into resisting democratic backsliding has so far focused on the activities of other kinds of political and civil society actors, not journalists. We found that the moderate institutional strategies deployed by VOA staff were much like those previously deployed by the SABC8, a group of journalists from the South African Broadcasting Corporation, who were dismissed for their refusal to censor news in the run-up to important municipal elections. But although VOA built a broad network of external alliances, they did not manage to develop the same level of widespread resistance to government capture found in South Africa, which involved mass street protests and a full parliamentary inquiry. Thus, other kinds of resistance strategies were sometimes more important in VOA's case. These involved journalists, managers, and other federal employees engaging in outward shows of compliance, while secretly tricking PAC's team or slow-walking responses to their instructions. These kinds of resistance to government capture and to democratic backsliding more broadly are extremely hard to study, precisely because they are usually hidden. We argue that such covert strategies were understandable emergency measures, given what was happening to the network under PAC's leadership and its relationship to broader trends of democratic backsliding. However, these kinds of hidden strategies are not a sustainable way of resisting government capture in the long term and leave the network open to allegations that it is run by a conspiratorial deep state. Therefore, we argue that more effective ways of protecting VOA need to be identified to protect the network from future attempts at politicization. We also see these changes as necessary to address ongoing problems the network was continuing to experience a year after the departure of PAC and his team. Specifically, we explain that VOA was struggling to return to the previous status quo because many of its journalists no longer felt safe from government capture, creating a reluctance among some to engage in original, critical reporting. VOA also continued to face difficulties in recruiting new journalists, particularly from overseas. Many staff were leaving, and there was an ongoing atmosphere of collegial mistrust, as well as the fear of potential retribution, given that the political climate could change again after the 2024 presidential election. We therefore challenge the assertion that the threats to the editorial independence of the outlets run by USAGM disappeared after PAC resigned in January 2021. We conclude this book by recommending specific actions to better protect VOA and other international PSM in the future. In this way, we hope to respond to the broader call to generate global strategies for combating media capture. 1.4. Building Theory. In this book, we use 7 previous cases around the world, as well as the rich empirical data from our own study, to develop an analytical model to better understand government capture of PSM. Although we are indebted to the groundbreaking work of Besley and Pratt on government capture, our research has been more heavily influenced by Dragomir and Horowitz's work. In an analysis of European PSM, they propose that researchers analyze 3 risk factors to understand government capture: structural capture, public discourse about PSM, and the role of PSM in society. Drawing on our research and previous studies of government capture, we refine the theoretical ideas discussed by Dragomir and Horowitz and introduce some new critical terms of our own. We begin by separating out the different dimensions of structural capture: the politicization of the governance structures of PSM and their funding. Drawing on Friedman's earlier work, 2019, we clarify the causes and processes involved in what we call governance capture. This includes highlighting how government appointees can politicize governance bodies and senior managerial teams of PSM by excluding or dominating other members. We found that this form of politicization is much easier when government supporters are also able to bring in other political allies via more fluid processes, such as commissioning external consultants, attorneys, and other short-term contractors. We also examine how government appointees and/or their attorneys may selectively apply journalists' statutory obligations regarding impartiality or balance within internal disciplinary procedures, in a manner that fosters journalistic self-censorship. Thus, governance capture may lead to the emergence of a particular form of regulatory capture, which we call internal disciplinary capture. In making this argument, we build on Yeşil's earlier work about the disciplinary capture of the Turkish media industry via the selective application of existing laws and regulations by proxy attorneys. We demonstrate that journalists' resistance to direct editorial interventions was significantly reduced by indirect forms of capture that changed their working conditions, leaving many of them overworked, stressed, and exhausted. Cost-cutting, which can follow a government's capture of the financial resources of a PSM, is clearly a crucial factor. However, we argue that it is also important to consider the politicization of the human resources required by a PSM. Analyzing what we call resource capture is particularly relevant to the study of international PSM, as these organizations struggle to function if they cannot recruit or retain foreign journalists with the linguistic skills and regional expertise required by their language services. These indirect forms of politicization and more direct editorial interventions tend to be legitimized by government appointees and their allies within various sorts of mediated discourse. Our research supports the claim made by Dragomir and Horowitz that such forms of discourse often involve publicly criticizing a PSM to reframe its societal role via a process that they call discursive capture. We also clarified the claim these authors make about PSM being more vulnerable to discursive capture if they lack a strong societal role, demonstrating how easy it is for government appointees to reframe the role of a PSM when it is ambivalently defined. We then infer how mediated criticism by Trump appointees and their allies lowered journalists' resistance to more direct editorial interventions by demoralizing them, an effect exacerbated by anonymous leaks from inside the agency to critical media. These leaks intensified distrust between colleagues and heightened the disciplinary effects of journalists' belief that USAGM was subjecting them to digital surveillance. The reluctance of VOA staff to communicate openly with one another via email and other digital applications, such as Teams, meant that they felt increasingly isolated, especially given that most were working from home at the height of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, it is also worth attending to the broader effects of this discursive capture. Unlike previous cases, the engagement of Pack and his allies in mediated discourse about VOA was not geared toward persuading the general public to change their minds about the societal role of the PSM. Instead, such forms of mediated discourse targeted Trump supporters via the partisan and often quite niche media they consumed. We then explain how these forms of mediated discourse were amplified and exaggerated by right-wing actors online and on social media to produce what we call networked discursive capture. International PSM are not usually discussed in relation to domestic politics, but we argue that they should be because possession of a multilingual international news network is an important symbol of power and prestige on the world stage. This cannot be separated from representations of nationhood at home. Indeed, we argue that references to international PSM can be extremely useful within populist nationalist discourse. In this case, representations of VOA within U.S. media helped promote ideological versions of U.S. national identity, to evoke nostalgic ideas about a return to past greatness, and to foster a sense of grievance against elites and other enemies blamed for the loss of that golden era. Thus, we stress that the political effects of government capture can extend far beyond changes to the PSM in question and the news it produces. Our new model of government capture also helps us explain how different forms of capture interact with one another, with journalistic practices, actors' agency, and with broader processes of democratic backsliding. This is because we embedded government capture theory within Roy Baskar's critical realist model, which is designed to interrogate recursive and complex causality. This book, therefore, seeks to advance theoretically beyond previous studies that have generated lists of risk factors and typologies of different forms of capture, or that have explored how these factors play out in context-specific ways within rich case studies. In so doing, we hope to address some of the limitations of this field of study, which stem from its origin in economics rather than journalism studies, media sociology, politics, or international relations. This new analytical model enabled us to understand that once one form of politicization became established, it tended to gain causal power, as political appointees and other Trump supporters were able to combine it with other practices and structures to produce new forms of politicization. These new forms of politicization could then be combined with each other, with earlier forms of politicization, and with still more practices and structures to produce further forms of politicization, and so on. Thus, increasingly complex systems of capture were generated, which became harder and harder for journalists to escape. Indeed, we found that by the time that VOA journalists were aware of direct editorial pressure, such systems were already at an advanced stage. This finding has led us to seriously question the efficacy of an editorial firewall without other effective safeguards to prevent government allies from politicizing a PSM's governance structure and its resources, as well as reinterpreting its purpose and relationship to the nation-state. Conceptualizing the extent of government capture in terms of the generation of increasingly complex systems also enables us to make comparisons without stripping out important context-specific detail. In this study, we compare how the extent of politicization varied between different groups of journalists working for a single news network during the same time period. But our analytical framework could also be used to compare how much a single news network was politicized at different points in time, or to compare the politicization of different news networks in one or more countries. Moreover, our model provides the analytical tools scholars need to explain how messy forms of government capture work, which may include some deliberate strategic plans alongside more ad hoc forms of policymaking, mistaken beliefs, opportunistic forms of trial and error, and some actions that had unintended consequences. Finally, although constraining journalists' ability to criticize those in power will always be central to any research into government capture, our new analytical model enables scholars to explore other kinds of political effects as well, which are vital to understanding the broader impact of government capture on democratic backsliding. 1.5. Conclusion. To conclude, then, in this chapter, we have explained our motivations to write this book and the important and timely contributions it makes to research into VOA. We have also argued that this case study has broader implications for our understanding of the relationships between international PSM and the governments that fund them. In addition, we explained the unique opportunity we had to build theory about how government capture works from the inside. This involved using an unusual and innovative mixed methods approach, which combined rare, semi-structured interviews with the analysis of documents drawn from FOI archives, court records, whistleblower complaints, and government reports, as well as material from the January 6 committee. We discussed how this book contributes to our understanding of why and how journalists and their managers seek to resist government capture and the efficacy of the strategies they use. Finally, we outlined our theoretical contribution, which involves developing key critical concepts about government capture and embedding them in the broader framework provided by critical realism to better understand the operation of complex causality. We will now explain how we have structured this book, including a systematic guide to how our critical arguments will proceed. 1.6. Map of the book. In Chapter 2, we outline the historical context of this case study within the U.S. The main purpose of this chapter is to demonstrate that both political parties have sporadically tried to control VOA's output over the course of its history. Indeed, the history of the network involves a profound struggle between professional norms of journalism and more controlled forms of strategic communication. This chapter also demonstrates that many of the issues that dominated the PAC period have strong historical precedents, including accusations of VOA's bias, allegations about infiltration by foreign spies, and recurrent managerial purges. However, we also find that the network gained greater editorial autonomy from the 1990s onward, when it moved from being directly controlled by the U.S. executive branch to being positioned within an independent federal agency governed by the bipartisan Broadcasting Board of Governors. This historical discussion enables us to clarify structural issues which are vital to our subsequent analysis. These include why VOA is classed as an international PSM network, even though its journalists are government employees, the ambivalent nature of VOA's charter and related legislation, the nature and legal standing of the editorial firewall, and why VOA's support services are embedded in its parent agency, USAGM. We will also outline the backgrounds of Michael Pack and other key actors, as well as explain the significance of key historical events like the Cold War and the McCarthyist Red Scare. Finally, we will clarify why, in 2017, the Obama administration transferred extensive powers from the bipartisan board to a single political appointee. This is part of our wider explanation of the circumstances in which Michael Pack was appointed as CEO of USAGM and why his appointment was so controversial. In Chapter 3, we introduce the concept of government capture, which will be used throughout this book to analyze what happened at VOA during PAC's tenure. We begin by discussing early work on government capture by Besley and Pratt, contextualizing this within the broader field of media capture. We will then examine what we already know about the government capture of PSM by outlining research into previous cases of politicization in the UK, Hungary, Poland, Japan, and Turkey. We will also discuss journalists' resistance to the politicization of public media in Slovakia and South Africa. In so doing, we use research by Dragomir and Horowitz to clarify the critical concepts of governance capture, resource capture, and discursive capture, as well as highlighting the vulnerabilities of PSM that lack a clear, well-established role. We also introduce a specific form of regulatory capture, disciplinary capture, which involves the promotion of self-censorship via proxy attorneys, selective application of laws and regulation. Finally, we outline the limitations of government capture theory and explain how we address them by embedding government capture theory using critical realism, which provides an overarching model of complex causality and social change. In Chapter 4, we begin to lay out our findings in relation to three forms of government capture, which indirectly politicized VOA during PAC's period in office. First, we explain how VOA's governance structures were captured when PAC took control of USAGM, as he replaced senior agency executives with political allies, dissolved the bipartisan boards of U.S.-funded international media, and fired their directors, apart from the director and deputy director of VOA, who resigned. He also replaced VOA's director, although the effects of this are disputed because he did not bring in an external political ally until after the election. We demonstrate that, from the beginning, White House officials tried to influence who occupied key managerial posts at VOA, even though these posts were not meant to be occupied by political appointees. Second, resource capture occurred when PAC's team froze VOA's funding and created a bureaucratic bottleneck, which severely limited the recruitment of journalists. The approach taken by PAC's team to the visas needed to employ foreign journalists was informed by one of Trump's executive orders. But we also explore the role of formative discussions between PAC's chief of staff and a White House official who was a close ally of Stephen Miller, the mastermind of Trump's immigration policies. Third, PAC justified his interventions within USAGM press releases and in interviews with right-wing media. We explain the significance of the discourse used by PAC in these media items, including his references to the glory days of the Cold War and the swamp. However, we go on to demonstrate the networked nature of discursive capture in this case, exploring complex and varied interactions between PAC's team, right-wing journalists, bloggers, social media participants, and conspiracy theorists. These interactions amplified and sometimes exaggerated PAC's claims, feeding into broader discourses already circulating among Trump supporters, which undermined faith in democratic institutions and processes and exacerbated the status threats to white conservative U.S. identity. In Chapter 5, we analyze why and how government capture directly influenced editorial matters at VOA. We argue that VOA's ambivalent diplomatic role enabled government capture when combined with governance capture, resource capture, and discursive capture. Specifically, we demonstrate that tensions between the different objectives contained within VOA's charter and accompanying legislation enabled PAC's team to reinterpret VOA's mission in ways that served partisan objectives. We begin by showing how PAC renegotiated these tensions to prioritize VOA's dissemination of government editorials. We then explore how PAC appeared to change his emphasis, prioritizing VOA's statutory responsibilities regarding political balance in relation to the network's coverage of the Black Lives Matter protests. Criticism from inside and outside USAGM prompted some VOA journalists to adopt practices of false balance, which inadvertently furthered Trump's discourse about racially charged status threats to white conservative Americans. Next, we examine how PAC's team instigated and influenced internal disciplinary investigations into VOA reports and even individual journalists for anti-Trump bias. We argue that these investigations shaped a form of internal disciplinary capture, since they involve PAC's attorneys selectively applying laws and regulation in ways that fostered journalistic self-censorship. We also examine how PAC's team moved from selectively applying existing laws and regulations to producing new regulations that sought to extend executive power into USAGM. In this way, governance capture tilted over into regulatory capture, eroding the agency's independence, thus furthering broader processes of democratic backsliding. Finally, we explain that journalists responded to government capture by engaging in varying degrees and kinds of self-censorship, with marked differences occurring between language service staff and their English language colleagues. Key variables explaining these differences included journalists' level of precarity.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.